I think for people born after the 90s, it's hard to understand just how truly new the internet is. Other connection services like email were being used before then, but the internet as we know it was created rapidly over the course of the 90s. While this series will be focusing primarily on flash games, it's important to note that the first web browser, the World Wide Web, was created in December of 1990, and while it would take a few more years before internet browsers would see widespread use, Flash was ultimately created as a browser tool. So that's where we'll start.
Welcome to the internet, your gateway to adventure.
The internet, as of time of recording, has been commercially accessible for less than 30 years. To put that in perspective, Super Mario World came out in Japan before that, and The Fresh Prince of Bel-Air, and subsequently Will Smith's entire acting career, is older than the internet as well. The internet at the start kinda sucked too. It barely saw any use until 1993 when Mosaic, a public version of the World Wide Web, was released. The internet's first websites were slow, drab, and difficult to build for. All this technology was very new, and suddenly everyone had to figure out an entirely new language just to learn how to use it. But despite its slow start, excitement was growing over this new technology. New programs and software were needed to help support these new websites, and two Californian companies in particular were about to add a lot of color to this new online world. The first company was Macromedia, founded in 1992 through a merger between Authorware Incorporated and Macromind Director. The two previous companies specialized in animation software, which made them well-positioned to create plugins for browsers. Quickly, Macromedia settled into the new niche of website development software. Their software was often designed with relatively sophisticated user interfaces that made them easy to learn and use. They quickly found success as customers lined up to start the foundations of their new websites. In 1993, a much smaller software development company was also formed. Co-founded by Jonathan Gay and Charlie Jackson, FutureWave initially focused on various tablet and drawing software. It's hard to say just how well FutureWave performed during the early 90s, but soon both companies would make major innovations for the World Wide Web. In 1995, Macromedia would release a huge software innovation in the form of Macromedia Shockwave. Shockwave, or rather, the Shockwave Player, a Netscape plugin, was an iteration from Macromind Director's scripting language. Shockwave allowed for much more complex animation and interactive elements. Many of the internet's first browser games were created with Shockwave. Shockwave was the first of its kind, and proved that developers were just getting started with what was even possible with web design. 1 year later, probably inspired somewhat by Macromedia Shockwave, FutureWave would create their own Shockwave titled Future Splash. Similarly, it was modified from their animation software SmartSketch. Future Splash had basic animation and graphics support, but innovated with its use of vector graphics. Using vectors saved significant resources and load times compared to Macromedia Shockwave. Future Splash's refined vector use also led to much smaller file sizes and smoother graphics. Future Splash's development tools were also very effective. With its simple, paint-like user interface, those who've worked with Flash before may recognize some of its core UI features, like the timeline, symbols, and button objects. Future Splash was marketed towards making animated, interactive web elements, and it quickly found its way onto websites. Suddenly, websites could be way more interactive, integrate sounds, and even animations. It was an interesting time for the internet.
Riddle wrapped in a mystery inside an enigma. Welcome to ZomboCon. This is ZomboCon.
It was soon clear that
This is ZomboCon. Welcome to ZomboCon.
It was
you
soon
can do anything at ZomboCon. Anything at all. The only limit is yourself. Welcome to ZomboCon.
It was soon clear that Future Splash was legitimate competition for Macromedia Shockwave. So, near the end of 2016, Macromedia bought out FutureWave and its proprietaries. Macromedia quickly re-released Future Splash Animator, shortening its name from Future Splash to simply Flash. And thus, Macromedia Flash was officially born. After the purchase, Macromedia drifted away from Flash's older sibling, Shockwave, instead shifting development resources to help refine FutureWave software. For the remainder of the 90s, they would quickly release 5 iterations of Flash, adding elements like the library, transparency, and ActionScript. ActionScript being Flash's unique programming language, loosely based on ECMA script. By the start of the 21st century, Macromedia had taken Future Splash and polished it into a strong, accessible animation and web development tool. 1995 would be the same year that a 17-year-old named Tom Fulp would register a domain titled Newgrounds. Out of all the creators I'm going to mention, no one is nearly as influential and well-known in the world of Flash as Fulp, who initially registered the Newgrounds domain as a follow-up to his Neo Geo fanzine. Newgrounds by no way was unique or revolutionary starting out. The site often gained recognition from Fulp and other somewhat controversial projects. For example, Fulp himself made a game called Club a Seal based on his memory of a graphic seal death he once saw in a documentary growing up. Now, for this series, I really wanted to highlight games that helped jumpstart notable Flash developer careers. Games that really innovated, or maybe they captured the public's attention in some way. And unfortunately for me, Fulp did make a game that garnered some views. Fulp's first Flash-based game, made in 1998, was called Teletubby Funland. I wanted to celebrate the history and importance of Flash games, and I decided to start with this one, huh? This was very much in line with Fulp and Newgrounds' initial image of trolling easily upset people. It's not what people usually talk about with Fulp's work, but it's unfortunately a pretty good example of the kind of content early Flash games were. Unpolished, simple, posts. Now, a lot of the games covered in this series may not have aged well, but it's important to not forget the past, even if it might be a bit ugly. Why Teletubbies, you might ask? The late 90s was a simpler time. Teletubbies was a silly, abstract show with toddlers as its primary demographic. As a mark to ridicule, it was honestly pretty tame in retrospect, especially compared to today's standards. Early trolls like Fulp probably were enjoying the absurdity of it, but since the target demographic for Teletubbies would have never been able to navigate the internet back in the day, it was mainly a way of just trolling easily angered parents. Not to say that the game was seen as just harmless fun. The BBC itself formally requested it be taken down. They threatened legal action, and the game itself was briefly removed. Copyright claim hadn't been really tested when it came to the internet, and the BBC would not be the ones to pull the trigger. Eventually, they backed down. That said, mocking the Teletubbies afterwards became a free web issue, although the BBC would never meaningfully back up their initial threats towards these parodies. Fulp would go on record simply stating, "As far as I've always known, Mad Magazine makes a living doing the same thing, and I'm pretty sure US laws protect me, but I am just a college kid and I don't have a lawyer. Hopefully the BBC will realize it's all in good fun." Fulp would not be known for simply inciting controversy, however. 1999 would see the release of the first game Fulp was truly known for, Pico School. Pico School was a great example of what Flash was actually capable of. It was a legitimate point-and-click adventure game with music and sprites that you could play relatively quickly in your browser. Flash's game-making tools were still primitive, as it was missing key elements of traditional programming languages, like the implementation of variables. While Pico School is by no means an amazing game, and it shares a lot of Fulp's earlier sense of humor, it was a huge innovation and it paved the way for things to come. What began as a small site for Fulp and some of his friends' projects changed in late 1999 when Newgrounds introduced a key feature, the Flash Portal. Initially a dumping ground for unused projects, Fulp often received submissions from users to put on the portal. Eventually, the amount of content became overwhelming, but Fulp's friend, a programmer named Ross Snyder, helped create the Grounds Gold system, which let users rate and curate submissions. Newgrounds became one of the first automated sites for user-submitted content. And the portal system was amazing at curating content too. It gave small rewards to users who frequently rated submissions, it allowed for easy filtering, and, most importantly, it deleted low-rated content early to keep their library clean of low-effort creations. The system probably wouldn't work for today's content-sharing sites due to their much higher volume of submissions, but for the comparatively smaller internet at the time, it was perfect. Creators were rewarded based on the quality of their work, and so were viewers for participating. Newgrounds filtered great creations quickly and efficiently. Eventually, it became the model of the many Flash Portal sites that would soon follow. Newgrounds would end up becoming a starting point for many Flash creators over the years, and we'll definitely see more of it, and Fulp, later. But for now, let's take a step back to observe the end of the 90s, as the internet was just starting to pick up steam. The late 90s was the era of sixth-generation consoles like Nintendo's GameCube, Microsoft's new Xbox, and Sony's record-breaking PlayStation 2. The games industry was exploding, and many companies were trying to get in on it. The internet seemed to be the perfect untapped market. Many companies sprung up overnight, investing in gaming-focused websites, such as Yahoo Games, Pogo, and others. Many hobbyists would also start creating sites, such as Albino Black Sheep, a notable blog that would go on to host animation and game jams that made the rounds around the web. Another hobbyist was a math teacher named Karen, who in 1997 created a series of educational-focused websites called the Cool Math Network. Now is not the time to dissect the true nature of the Cool Math Network. One day we'll get to Cool Math Games. One day. Two other hobbyists would be Adam Powell and Donna Williams, who in late 1999 would make waves with an online virtual pet website called Neopets. For those unfamiliar, Neopets was one of the first big entertainment-focused websites at the start of the 21st century. Originally created by two students for themselves at the University of Nottingham, it's kind of insane how quickly the shell of Neopets was created by such a small team. Originally, Powell was the sole programmer and Williams did all of the design. At its core, you could have several pets you fed, took care of, and played with in a large number of minigames, to a degree. Significant portions of the site were developed and dependent on Flash, such as the majority of its navigational assets. The site was purchased mere months after its conception by American businessman Doug Doring, creatively calling the company Neopets Incorporated. This led to an expansion of staff, with the original creators still contributing to the site. By October of 2000, Neopets had a significant number of Flash games, and even gave awards to players who got one of the three highest scores for that month. The site rapidly developed between 2000 and 2005, eventually being bought by Viacom, who cross-promoted it with their TV network, Nickelodeon. While initially they viewed the IP as a strong foundation for its franchise appeal, they struggled to branch out into other financial sectors, and slowly committed less and less resources to it. After an identity theft hacking scheme in 2009, Viacom became much less eager to promote their property, and with Flash's popularity declining near the end of 2010, they would eventually sell the site to Jumpstart in 2014, both later being acquired by NetDragon in 2017. By the end of 2019, the site had stagnated and decayed somewhat after the changes in ownership and its failed reworks. Elements of the original site were still there, lingering as a former shell of what it once was, which is a shame. Neopets was like this insane toy box of ideas, and while not every element of the site was a home run, there was an insane amount of innovation and creativity throughout the site that deserves respect for what it was. In 2020, plans were announced to completely rework the site and make it more mobile-focused, removing and reworking a lot of Neopets' core mechanics to hopefully target the new, larger mobile market. Whether or not Neopets' shrinking fanbase will be willing to follow remains to be seen. If you're interested in Neopets' history, other creators have gone over it in far better detail than I could hope to do so, and, well, it's hard for me, as someone who's had casual experience from the site growing up, to really separate the many rumors from fact about Neopets' development. For instance, things I've found during my research include speculation for why Bruce Forsyth and Macy Gray were originally Neopets and were probably removed due to some kind of image rights issue, and why they decided to turn one of these real people into a penguin. Various reasons for redesigns, reboots, and retoolings of systems, including attempts at introducing microtransactions. However the heck the Altador Cup actually worked. Why would people want Brightvale to win? That doesn't make sense. It's not a popularity. The idea that two pets were made out of spite towards the change in ownership, it seems like they needed one Neopet for each letter, although apparently Ogryn still might have been designed to be ugly. Sorry, Ogryn. And the site's supposed involvement with Scientology in the early 2000s, resulting in the development of the experience system. To summarize my own young experiences with it, it had complex story-driven ARGs, a decently fleshed-out stock market simulator, a complex in-game economy, a form with some actual degree of moderation and filters, and it encouraged me to teach myself HTML so I could make my guild website look fancy. Doug Doring, besides probably making out like a bandit after selling Neopets at nearly the perfect time, would later become the founder and executive chairman of Age of Learning Incorporated and abcmouse.com, where he works to this day. Adam Powell and Donna Williams eventually stopped working on Neopets in 2007, a few years after Viacom's purchase. Powell and Williams would get married the year after. After leaving Neopets, they would go on to make a new game-focused site called Meteor Games, which also relied heavily on Flash. But Viacom would eventually lay off most of its staff in 2011, a mere 3 years later. Since then, the pals have tried one more time to develop a game loosely called Moglings, but they encountered some unknown difficulties around 2016, and the resulting project has been shelved indefinitely. Afterwards, both of the pals have had a humble and largely offline presence, occasionally popping up on Reddit. By the end of Neopets' life, they had created over 1,300 unique games, the vast majority using Flash or Flash elements in some regard. It's interesting to note that while the vast majority of early online game websites usually had a majority of male users, Neopets is one of the few exceptions, appealing to a larger core female demographic. Neopets primarily used Flash how it was intended to be used, as a web development tool. But ultimately, its interactive, innovative, and unique systems were what kept users invested and playing long after similar sites of the era. Creators were now realizing that Flash could be used for things that were much, much more interesting than just animated banners and buttons. And with that insight, the start of the new century would belong to Flash.
This is ZomboCom, and welcome to you who have come to ZomboCom. Anything is possible at ZomboCom. You can do anything at ZomboCom. The infinite is possible at ZomboCom. The unattainable is unknown at ZomboCom. Welcome to ZomboCom. This is ZomboCom.
Wait, what? Why?